Good morning.
Welcome to this morning's worship service. A very special welcome to you if you happen to be a guest or a visitor with us today. And if you're one of those folks, a visitor with us, we'd be delighted if we could welcome you a little more formally, if you'd be willing to stand up and introduce yourself. But we don't require that. It's more of a request. But do we have any first-time visitors with us this morning? All right, then, I'm going to move on. First of all, thank you for 2 weeks vacation. It was great. Always appreciate it. You actually paid me to be gone, so hey, there you go. Boy, we have a lot of stuff going on today. Before I get into that, I just want to remind those of you who are sitting closest to those burgundy worship folders to go ahead and, if you haven't already, to take those folders out and begin to put your information in there. Just a reminder that if you have a prayer need, inside those folders are one of these. It's a welcome card, but it's not just a welcome card. If you have a prayer need, on the back side there's a place where you can put your name and you can write your prayer need or make a prayer request. And if that's what you're doing, then I invite you to hang on to it. And at the conclusion of today's service, just take this card with your prayer request and put it in the box by the front doors that's on a pedestal that has praying hands on it, and your prayer request will be gathered by our prayer ministry and prayed over throughout the week. Also, if you'd like some private prayer time with one of our prayer ministers, then at the conclusion of this morning's service, just gather here at the altar rail closest to the pulpit. And one of our prayer ministers will be glad to meet you there and to greet you and to share a prayer with you. Altar flowers today, I want to thank Ralph Bunting for all altar flowers in loving memory of Judy. I want to thank Philip and Bev Gehring for altar flowers today in celebration of their fifth wedding anniversary. Also in your bulletin, you probably saw one of these, or hopefully you have one of these. And maybe you noticed as you came in today, our new bus parked outside. It's all logoed up and ready to go. And we are really setting off on a new bus ministry. So we want to use that bus not just for youth or for seniors or for the disabled or for our special needs folks. We're looking at ways to use that bus as a tool for ministry and expand the kinds of things we're doing. And we are in the midst of a fundraiser to pay for the bus. And our goal is $50,000. The bus didn't cost that much. I think we're about 36, 38, something like that. But anything that we get toward this bus, then we will be using toward acquiring a second bus. Because the fact of the matter is, both our vans are past their due date, so to speak. And those vans for transportation are becoming harder and harder for us to get insurance on. People don't want to insure 15-passenger vans anymore. Also, they're just plain difficult. Difficult for handicapped folks, difficult for older folks to get in and out of. The new bus, it has two seats on each side, a nice big center aisle. It has a handicap lift for wheelchair, a wheelchair lift, so that, you know, we can transport, you know, some of the less physically able folks, maybe down to Diamondback games or whatever. Charlie Clegg's going to talk to us in a minute about an important ministry that he's generating. So we really do need your help. And so I would ask you to pray. If there's some way, there's some funds you have squirreled away that you were wondering what the Lord wanted you to do with those, maybe it is to support this important bus ministry of our congregation. So without further ado, I'm going to invite Charlie Clegg to come forward, and he's going to share a few words with you about one aspect of our bus ministry.
Thank you. Good morning.
Well, as Pastor Jack says, we've initiated a new ministry here, a bus ministry. And if you haven't become aware of it, go to the east parking lot, turn right, and you can't miss it. It's a beautiful bus. It's new to us. Now it has tags and it's insured, and in a moment I'm going to give you an opportunity to help with this ministry. So have something to write with and something to write on when I get to that point. We will start our bus ministry by servicing our members at Samaritan Village. Now, we've got several members over there, and most of them find it difficult getting from there to here because of the parking lot and the incline. While this bus is not like driving the family SUV, there will be an orientation for new drivers and assistants. It's a bit longer than most of us are used to driving. If this sounds interesting to you, if you would like more information, you can contact me by calling 928-925-2256. I know you're all writing this down right now, so. That's 928-925-2256, or you can call the church office at 928-445-4348. 928-445-4348, and they'll forward your information to me. I want to thank you for making this ministry possible. It's been challenging getting people from Samaritan Village here. And in the future, if we find the need for other retirement communities to service, we're looking forward to doing that too. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlie. Just a note, if you would like to you're done, Charlie. If you would like to take a tour of the bus, doesn't take too long. David has told me that the bus will be open following this service. You can go out and take a look at it, go inside if you want, sit down, take a nap, whatever you need to do. But again, please prayerfully consider being a financial contributor to the bus. There are special offering envelopes, I believe, in the pew racks that you can use. If you're going to write a check, be sure to put in the memo line, bus ministry, so we can get that taken care of. With that, I'm going to invite you to stand as you are able. We'll quiet our minds, we'll center our hearts, and prepare to come into the worship of our Lord.
We begin our worship this 13th Sunday after Pentecost in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us remember the gift of baptism and confess our sin. O God, we yearn to be a community of believers, united in your Spirit, and yet we are fraught with divisions, denominational, political, theological. We are weighed down by tensions and things that break us apart. Forgive us, great God, for this great sin. Help us to learn to live in community together, loving one another in spite of our differences and respecting one another in everything that we say and do. Help us to be, as you call us, one in heart and mind. Only through the grace of your Son, Jesus Christ, can we achieve this. Amen. God has received us, pardoned us, and loved us through Christ Jesus, who took our sins to the cross. Through him we are forgiven. Let us too forgive each other in love and share the peace of Christ. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Now, please share the love of Christ with each other.
Thank you.
Let us pray together. God, our church body, to walk in a manner worthy of the calling you have given us. Help us in all our interactions with one another to have humble and gentle hearts. Grant us patience for one another, bearing with one another in love. Grant the body of Christ unity. May we walk humbly with you, allowing you to show us our wrongs. Amen. Please be seated.
See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord, your God, that I command you today, by loving the Lord, your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away, and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life that you and your offspring may live. Loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him, for he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give up. The word of the Lord.
This is the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 14th chapter. Now great crowds accompanied Jesus, and he turned and he said to them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, 'This man began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to encounter another king in war, will not sit down first and deliberate whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, any of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. I love being an American. And I imagine that's a feeling that the vast majority, if not all of you, also share. And there's a lot of things I love about being an American. And maybe one of the best things I love about being an American is enjoying the freedom that comes from being a citizen of this great nation. Now, we're not perfect. We have our problems, and Lord knows we have our disagreements and that sort of thing. But our freedom is an amazing thing. It can't be diminished by any of the arguments that we have or any of the petty differences that we have. We share that freedom in common. But, you know, sometimes, like many Americans, I take for granted so much about what it means to be American. And one of those things I have come to take for granted is freedom. And in particular, the freedom we have as Americans to choose. We have all kinds of choices, and they are for us to make. I sometimes take for granted the freedom that I have to choose to be part of an amazing political process, as nasty as it can sometimes get, but this amazing process where we choose our nation's leader every 4 years. We make the choice about who leads us. And I sometimes take for granted the freedom I have to be part of that political process. I sometimes take for granted the fact that I am free to choose where I live. And where I work, and who I associate with, and who I don't associate with, and how I spend my spare time. And I, like many Americans, have even taken for granted the wonderful freedom I have to choose how I want to approach my relationship with God. An amazing thing. You know, other nations around the world, you know, you're forced into a box. This is what you, as a citizen of this nation, this is the God you will worship. And this is how you will worship that God. We don't know such a thing here. I mean, to believe or not to believe, that's our choice. It's an amazing choice. And let's say we choose to believe in God. Then our choices only begin to multiply, right? As Americans, we're Buddhists and Muslims and Jews and Hindus and Mormons and Christians and all that stuff. Excuse me. And let's say we choose to be a Christian. Then the choices continue to multiply, right? We can be a Presbyterian or a Lutheran or a Methodist or a Catholic or a Baptist or a Pentecostal or on and on and on. It's just amazing when it comes to God, the choices that are available to us as Americans. And not only do we get to choose our particular flavor of religion, but we also get to choose just how faithfully or unfaithfully we want to practice our particular flavor of faith. No, we have freedom to choose. For instance, each of us can choose if we want to be, let's say if we're a Christian, we can choose to be an anonymous Christian, right? Or we can choose to be a more devout Christian. Or we can choose to be something in between. We can choose to be radically obedient to God's will as it is revealed to us in Scripture. Or we can choose to follow a spiritual path of our own creation. And of course, every choice we make carries with it the resulting ramifications. So if we choose to follow God's will, our lives will look very different than if we choose to reject God's plan and do our own thing. What I want to talk about in my message this morning is the importance of Christians making good choices. And in particular, I want to talk about the importance of Christians making good choices in their relationships with other Christians. There's an old saying that Christians aren't perfect, just forgiven. And sometimes we take that to an extreme, and it was never meant to say that, you know, go do whatever you want, don't worry about it, because God's going to forgive you, though sometimes that's where people take that. But it is a reminder to us that we aren't perfect. We don't have all the answers. We're not mistake-free. But in the midst of that is grace, God's grace. But it's important that we remember there's also supposed to be grace between us, so that just as God forgives us in our imperfections, we are called to follow in the footsteps of Christ and forgive each other in our imperfections. It is this imperfect aspect of the Christian faith that can sometimes lead to dissension, and it has. And sometimes it can even lead to full-blown fractured relationships, and it has. Appropriate choices, though, can help us to avoid dissension, and appropriate choices can help us to heal the fractures that occur from time to time. In our Old Testament reading for today, God talks about our making a choice. The Lord says, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, and I have set before you death and adversity." I think it's worded a little different in our reading, but that's from Deuteronomy 30:15. "I have set before you life and prosperity and death and adversity." And it sounds to me that God is giving us an invitation to choose one or the other. But what kind of choice is that, you say? I mean, life or death, prosperity or adversity. Who in their right mind would be foolish enough to choose death over life or adversity over prosperity? And yet we know people do that all the time. All kinds of people in all kinds of circumstances and situations choose death over life, choose adversity over prosperity. But apparently there are plenty of folks ready to make wrong choices. So God feels compelled then to add a little bit of advice, just in case you're thinking, death would be okay and adversity would be okay. God says, choose life. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live. Now, what does that mean, to choose life? And it's really quite simple. This is not rocket science, folks. Our Old Testament reading reminds us that we choose life when we love the Lord, we obey the Lord, we remain close to the Lord. That's simple. That is life. We love the Lord, obey Him, remain close to Him. Or as our New Testament reading from Luke's Gospel puts it, we choose life when we consider the cost of discipleship. Okay, this is what it's going to mean if I'm a Christian. And then we take up our cross, right? And we follow in the footsteps of Jesus, which is what He calls us to do. That's how we choose life. It's not that difficult. It's spelled out for us clearly in Scripture. In essence, to choose life and prosperity is to follow in the example of Jesus Christ. To choose death and adversity is to insist on doing things our own way or the world's way. Said a little differently, if we have a difficult choice to make in life, and we do, don't we? All the time, challenging choices. If we have a difficult choice to make, let's say in our relationship with another person, then it is always imperative that we ask, what would Jesus do? Right? Whose footsteps are we following in? Jesus' footsteps. It's very clear. So how do we figure out how to choose life, how to follow Jesus? We ask ourselves, what would Jesus do? What would Jesus say? How would Jesus react? And once we've determined what we believe that Jesus would do based upon Scripture, then we are to follow in His example. It amazes me how many people know Scripture and yet don't follow it. I mean, we can quote all kinds of Bible verses, but if you want to see an example of that in your own life, sometimes it's hard to see. We have to not only believe what Scripture says, but we have to then be willing to obey, to follow in the example of Christ when we approach the world and when we approach our problems, when we approach our challenges, and especially when we approach our relationships with one another. What would Jesus do? What would Jesus say? How would Jesus react to this situation? We have to take a look at our relationships with one another, always first and foremost from the vantage point of Jesus Christ. What would Jesus do? So I'm going to share with you a few words of advice. Those words are in regard to choosing wisely, choosing life over death, choosing prosperity over adversity. Now, the following are not my words. They are the words, I wish they were my words, by the way, but they are the words of one of my favorite authors, Max Lucado. These words of advice on choosing life, they are found in a book of his called When God Whispers Your Name. It's a keeper, all right? It's an oldie but a goodie. When God Whispers Your Name. And appropriately, the title of this chapter is The Choice. The Choice. So, Lucado writes, it's quiet. It's early. My coffee is still hot. The sky is still black. And the world is still asleep. But the day is coming. No, in a few moments, the day will arrive. It will roar down the track with the rising of the sun, and the stillness of the dawn will be exchanged for the noise of the day, and the calm of solitude, it will be replaced by the pounding pace of the human race. And the refuge of the early morning, it will be invaded by decisions to be made and deadlines that must be met. So for the next 12 hours, I will be exposed to all the day's demands. It is now. It is now that I must make a choice. I must make a choice. And because of Calvary, because of the cross, I am free to choose. And so I will choose. I will choose to love. Today I will love God. And today I will love what God loves. And I will love those God loves. Today I will choose joy. I will invite my God to be the God of all my circumstances. I will refuse the temptation today to be cynical. That is the tool of a lazy thinker. No, I will refuse to see people as anything less than human beings created and loved by God. And I will refuse to see a problem as anything less than one more opportunity to see God. I will choose joy, and then I will choose peace. I will live forgiven, and I will forgive so that I may live. I will choose peace. I will choose patience. I will overlook the inconvenience of the world, and instead of cursing the one who seems to take my place, I will invite him to do so, and rather than complain that the wait is too long, I will thank God for this moment to pray. And instead of clenching my fist at new assignments, I will face them with joy and courage. I will choose patience. And I will choose kindness. Kindness. I will be kind to the poor, for they are alone. I will be kind to the rich, for they are afraid. I will be kind to the unkind, for such is the way that God has treated me. I choose kindness. And I choose goodness. And I will go without a dollar before I take a dishonest one. And I will be overlooked before I boast. And I will confess before I accuse, because I choose goodness. I choose faithfulness. Today, I will keep my promises. Today, my debtors will not regret their trust in me. My associates will not question my word. My wife will not question my love. My children will never fear that their father will not come home. I choose faithfulness. I choose gentleness. You know, nothing is won by force. So I choose to be gentle. And so if I raise my voice, may it only be in praise. And if I clench my fist, may it only be in prayer. If I make a demand, may it only be of myself. I choose gentleness. And I choose self-control. Because I am a spiritual being. And after this body of mine is dead, my spirit will soar. And so I refuse to let what will rot rule what is eternal. I choose self-control. I will be drunk only with joy. I will be impassioned only by my faith. I will be influenced only by God. And I will be taught only by Christ. I choose self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. It is to these that I will commit my day. And if I succeed, I will give thanks. And if I fail, I will seek grace. And then when this day is done, I will place my head on my pillow and rest. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, are these the words that describe the world we live in? I hope they're the words that describe you, what's in your heart, because they are the words that describe the one who died for you and who calls you to take up your cross and follow him. Choose wisely, my friends. Choose life. Choose that which brings a blessing and prosperity, not only to you, but to your family and to your church, and yes, to a stranger, and especially to your relationship with God. Make choices today that will not allow adversity and sin and death to rule over your life, or add even more strife to an already broken and despairing world. Choose wisely. Choose those things that Jesus would choose. Live your life as Jesus would live. Be the disciple that Jesus has called you and created you to be, and carry that cross that he has called you to carry. Choose life. Choose wisely. Choose love over hate, forgiveness over vindictiveness, joy over despair, self-control over personal passions, faithfulness over fickleness, hope over fear, the cross over the grave. Know full well that the choices we make will not always be easy. They almost never are. But God is always nearby. God is always willing to help us to overcome our foolishness and our frailty, so that we might make the right choices in even the most difficult of circumstances. And God also remains nearby to show us a moment of grace, that in our failures, we might know his mercy and his forgiveness, so that at the end of the day we are able to lay our head upon our pillow and rest in peace. Let us pray. Lord, please make me an instrument of your peace in this world. And where there is hatred, let me be the one who sows love. And where there is injury, let me be the one who seeks pardon for myself and others. Where there is discord, let me be a source of unity. Where there is doubt, let me be one who brings the word of faith. Where there is despair, let me be the one who brings a word of hope. Where there is darkness, let me be light. And where there is sadness, let me be one of joy. Grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as I seek to console others, to be understood as I seek to understand others, and to be loved as I seek to love others. For it is in giving that I receive, it is in pardoning that I am pardoned, and it is in dying that I am born to eternal life. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep our hearts and our minds one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. With that, I'm going to invite you to stand as you are able. We'll sing our hymn of the day. It's printed in your bulletin, "To God Be the Glory."
believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He is conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into hell. He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again. The Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may now be seated. As the ushers receive our tithes and offerings, may our giving be a pleasant fragrance to the God of eternal love.
Through eternity.
O God of all bounty, from your hand we have freely received. Accept these offerings of your people as expressions of our thanks. Lovingly remember those who have given, enrich the lives of those for whom these gifts are intended, and use these gifts to promote goodwill and to bring your kingdom for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ and Savior. Amen. Joining our voices now with God's people around the world, let us offer our prayers for those in need. Father God, we are thankful that all who believe in your Son can become your adopted children. Your word says you are pleased with us when we put our religion into practice by caring for our own family. We are further called by you to be part of and to provide for our spiritual family, the church. Thank you for this church we call home, and bless it with many more years of successful ministry. Prompt each of us to carry our cross so that all may come to know you. Unite us in spirit, in truth, and in love. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Savior, we ask for mercy and comfort for all those impacted by the hurricanes in the Atlantic. Be with all rescue efforts and recovery efforts, and bring strength and healing to all those affected by this terrible calamity. We also ask for comfort and peace for all who are alone or lonely, and do not know the joy of true fellowship that comes through the body of believers. Lay the names on our hearts at this time that you specifically want us to share our faith with, and let joy and loving kindness be felt by those we silently name at this time. Lord, in your mercy. Prince of Peace, we ask that you would plant seeds of love and respect in our hearts for all people, regardless of our differences. Please help us as much as it depends on us to live in peace with everyone. We also pray for healthy marriages and Christ-centered homes. May hatred and bigotry cease, and may we combat all that divides us with the light of your love, Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. We commend these and all our prayers to you, O God. Come near to us with your saving help. For the sake of Christ Jesus, our risen Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Go with God's blessing. May God be at your side, especially in the valleys of death. May Christ Jesus be the cornerstone of your whole life. And may the Holy Spirit abide in you and tend to you with love and mercy all the days of your life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thank you.